Wiki-how 24. Emotional health and well-being, health for kids and teens, category, youth underscore. https://www.wikihow.com/run-away-from-home. https://www.wikihow.com/have-a-healthy-sex-life-left-teens. https://www.wikihow.com/run-away-intelligently. https://www.wikihow.com/run-away-from-home-as-a-teen. https://www.wikihow.com/be-a-good-boy. https://www.wikihow.com/run-away-from-abusive-home. How to run away from home. Download article. Parts. 1. Weighing the pros and cons. 2. Starting off. 3. Planning long-term strategies for survival. Plus show one more. Other sections. Questions and answers. Related articles. References. Article summary. Author info. Last updated, the 12th of July, 2024. Fact checked. Running away is a major decision. You may need some time to think about whether you want to run or not. There are many reasons why young people would want to run away from home. Some of them good, and some of them not so good. Remember to think of the bad things that can happen. Probably the most important thing for young people to understand is that running away is a lot harder, and a lot less glamorous, than you may think. There are cold, sleepless nights, there is danger and hunger, there is a general sense of being lost and not knowing where you need to go. That being said, there may be legitimate reasons for wanting to run away. Read this article to help you weigh the consequences and get a head start if you end up deciding that's the right call for you. Part 1. Weighing the pros and cons. Download article. 1. Stop and think about your actions. Why do you want to run away? Is there a really good reason to run away, or are you just bored or tired with your situation? There's a difference between running away for a good reason, child maltreatment perpetrated by parents, and running away for a bad reason, you just got in a small fight with your parents. Don't make a hasty decision in the heat of anger, you might regret it later. 2. Think about all the people you might be affecting by running away. Humans are social. We bond together out of need and necessity, but also because we gain satisfaction from being close to one another. Try to think about the people who will be seriously affected by your decision. You owe it to them. You may not know it, but they think about you all the time. Think about your parents. Though it may not always seem like it, your parents love you deeply. They see themselves in you, and they want a better future for you than they want for themselves. Fights and disagreements happen with parents, their love for you never changes. Think about the rest of your family. Your brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, grandmothers and grandfathers, all of them have a relationship that's deeper than just a friendship. It's very possible that your family will feel hurt and responsible for you running away, even if they had nothing to do with it. Think about your friends. Your friends are the lifeblood of your social circle. They laugh with you, they make you feel better when you're down, they sometimes even think of you like a brother or sister. Running away probably means leaving them behind. Think of other mentor figures. Maybe it's a teacher, maybe it's a friend of your mother's. Many of us have mentors who look after us. They want to see us succeed and be safe. Your decision will undoubtedly have an effect on them. 3. Understand that in many cases, running away from home is illegal. Although most states won't punish minors, someone under the age of 18, for running away from home, several states consider it illegal. In Georgia, Idaho, Kentucky, Nebraska, South Carolina, Texas, Utah, West Virginia, and Wyoming, running away from home is a status offense, meaning that it's against the law if you are under 18. However, if your parents or guardians have tried to hurt you, you should get away. And this is perfectly legal, but you have to do it in the right way. Tell a teacher or other trusted adult or call the police. Make sure you have a place to stay for a night or two before you do this, so you don't have to go anywhere weird. You may worry that foster care will be worse than being with your parents, even if they hurt you, but it is better to risk it. You may even be able to stay with another family member or friend if you work this out in advance. Even if you do run away in a state that doesn't have laws against it, you could still find yourself in court. Over 30 states consider children who chronically run away from their homes child in need of supervision or CHINS, a process which is designed to help children lead better lives. Still, minors who are in the CHINS process may face fines, suspended privileges, and mandatory drug screenings. 4. Talk to someone about your plans to run away. Consider calling 1-800-786-2929, 1-800-RUN. Away, or going to http://www.1800runaway.org to talk about your situation and all the options you have. 5. Address the motivation for wanting to run away, if possible. There are many reasons why a child would want to run away. Addressing the reason why could help you solve the problem before it gets so bad that you feel forced to run away. Here are some statistics. 47% of runaway youth described having a significant problem with one or both of their parents. Is there another adult who might give you advice about how to work the problem out with your parents? If not, consider calling Child Protective Services. 1. 2. More than 50% of runaway youth in shelters said that their parents told them to leave or knew they were leaving but didn't care. If your parents ask you to leave or tell you they don't care about you leaving, call or visit Child Protective Services. 3. It's not betraying your parents to want to find someone who cares about you. You deserve that. 80% of runaway and homeless girls reported physical and sexual abuse. If you are the victim of physical or sexual abuse, find an adult who you can confide in. It may be your parents, it may not be, and visit the police to file a report. 6. Write a list of all the pros and cons of running away. Often, putting your thoughts down on paper has a soothing effect, making things more clear in the process. Here are some possible pros and cons of running away. The pros: possible freedom from neglect, abuse, verbal, physical, or sexual, and / or harassment. Opportunities to travel, see new places, and meet new people. Increased freedom and the possibility of maturity and personal growth. No matter how hard it gets. Development of self-reliance, a sense of being able to do things by, and entirely for, yourself. The cons: increased likelihood of spending nights outdoors, on the streets, under bridges or overhangs, or even on top of roofs. Increased likelihood of depression, isolation, and powerlessness, 32% of runaway youth have attempted suicide at some point in their lives. Increased likelihood of violence, drugs, disease, and prostitution on the streets. Increased likelihood of death or serious injury. Feeling like you have no one to talk to, like no one cares, or like the things you do don't make a difference. 7. Give your emotions 1 week to cool off before making any big decisions. Often, we let our emotions make decisions for us when we think we are being rational. This can be a good thing. But sometimes it's bad because we trick ourselves into thinking that we are being rational. To let your emotions cool off and really give yourself time to think about your possible life-changing decision, wait a week before doing anything. Reach out to people you can trust and perhaps talk it over with them. After a week, your rational brain will probably have had time to make a decision. This is different for each case, and so you should weigh the consequences for running away if your parents were to find you. Some parents get mad at you, instead of trying to help you. 4. Part 2. Starting off. Download article. 1. Plan ahead. Think of what you will do if any part of your plan goes wrong, and make up excuses for everything. Here are some things that you always need to consider. What will you do if you get sick? What will you do if you are caught? What will you eat? How will you maintain good hygiene? How will you stay off the streets and out of harm's way? How will you earn enough money to survive? 2. Try to find a safe place to stay with someone you can trust. If you have someone who's helping you run away and can stay with them at least for a little while, you're pretty much set. However, if that's not a possibility, where will you take shelter? 3. Pack up a bag with some essentials. Travel light, bring only the bare essentials. Now is not the time to set a record for pounds carried. Bring food, money, extra changes of clothing, a jacket or coat in case it gets cold, clothes with pockets, a toothbrush, toothpaste, soap, shampoo, and anything else you will need. If you don't want to be recognized, take with you only the clothes you wear least often. Some other things that might be useful are maps, an umbrella, a utility knife, a combination lock, a face mask, and a blanket. Don't bring your phone or any electronic devices. Even if you turn your location off, there are easy ways for people to track you. You can buy a very cheap phone with cash if you really need one. 4. Try to bring some of your allowance but don't take enough to get you noticed. Maybe $10 for a bus or other transportation, and $50 just in case. If you plan to steal the money, find a place where you can get it fast without being spotted by your parents. If you have a credit card, take it, as it's much harder to steal and use, and you can cancel it at any time. Be prepared for your parents to possibly cancel it. However, when they find out that you've run away, don't use it as your only source of money. Also, using a credit/debit card can give away your hiding place. The bank can track down your card and see what stores and shops to which you've been. You need to be aware of these things and store your money wisely. 5. Wait until you have the right opportunity to make a run for it. Make sure you have plenty of time to get away before anyone notices you're gone. Try making your move as soon as you get to school in the morning, or as soon as everyone in your home leaves and you know they won't be coming back for a long time. When you do book it, make it snappy. The last thing you want is for anyone in the neighborhood to notice you leaving. 6. Find a method of transportation. You will likely want to have a quick and easy way of getting around. The city bus is your best bet, or a long-distance traveling bus if you're leaving the town/city. Part 3. Planning long-term strategies for survival. Download article. 1. Make up a story. You'll have to accept that at some point, someone is going to want to know where you came from, or what you are doing. You're probably going to need to do some thinking about this. Think of something reasonable and realistic, but don't say you ran away. Keep it simple. You'll want to remember it everywhere you go because word gets out quite fast in this world about anything, so you should probably keep your story the same all throughout your life as a runaway, just to avoid arousing suspicion. Avoid inconsistencies by thinking out the details ahead of time. If you are really serious about running away permanently, change your name. Have fun with it, but don't choose anything too wacky that you wouldn't name your kid it. Think about it, something common would probably be best because it'll be harder to remember, and your main aim is not to become well known. But don't use a name that's only become well known or used very recently. Try to pick out a name from the year you were born. 2. Live near large grocery stores or candy stores. These places will usually have food samples open to the public which you can snack on, though make sure you take a cart with you and try to look like you have a purpose, don't hang around. Also, you can use the public bathrooms to wash yourself and do your business. It's not glamorous, but you can always go dumpster diving at the back of large grocery stores. You'll be seriously surprised about what people throw away. The more you dumpster dive, the more your system will get used to food that's past its prime. In the beginning, it might be quite uncomfortable, but it should get better. 3. Find shelter if you haven't. If you don't have a place to stay, you'll have to find shelter elsewhere. Try finding a reasonably safe spot under a bridge, in an alcove, in an abandoned building somewhere, or perhaps in a public building that stays open 24/7. If these don't work out, try looking for the nearest homeless shelter and check their availability. If you just need a place to stay in order to pass the time, public libraries, popular stores, churches, college buildings, airports, and train stations are all possible options. These places are safe, while generally having enough people about to make it easy for you to go unnoticed. In the winter months, You may want to try to find a building with an elevator if you are in a downtown area. Try climbing the stairs next to an elevator shaft all the way to the top. You may find a room that is nice and warm, that not too many people go into. Stay away from the woods or the desert. These places are generally very rural and make it easier for other people to victimize you. As romantic as it may seem, it's really hard to make a living off of the land nowadays, especially if you know nothing about plant and animal species. Try to find places with other people around, they're usually safer. 4. You'll probably begin to need money at some point, so learn how to panhandle. Panhandling is asking other people for money. There's not much pride in it, and many people will flat out ignore you, but with the right strategies, you could be quite successful, and maybe even get enough to save some money. Choose the right location. Find a busy place where people walk, such as outside a mall area, a convenience store, or a place where people come out with change. Ask patrons for money after they come out of the store, not before. Alternatively, ask drivers for money on a busy intersection. Make sure you're on the side where the driver's seat is. Smile and ask people for change politely and softly. You won't get very much money if you look mean, frustrated, or unhappy. When someone does give you money, thank them with a smile and a friendly remark. 5. Don't use the foreign accent ploy. Some people find faking a foreign accent tempting, but this is typically a bad idea. A foreign accent draws attention to yourself. People will want to know more about you and your culture, when you should really be trying to be as invisible as possible. Moreover, faking an accent is extremely difficult. It doesn't matter how good you think your foreign accent is, it matters how much everyone else does. 6. Maintain yourself. This part is by far the hardest, particularly maintaining a healthy diet and good hygiene. Hospitals are known to keep exceptionally clean restrooms and offer good privacy. Here are some other tips that you can use to keep your hygiene high even if your spirits are low. Use bathrooms in big grocery stores. There's not much privacy, but there's very little foot traffic. Think about it, how often do you use the restroom in a grocery store? You'll probably be able to give yourself a nice little hand bath here and use some of the free soap provided. Use generic sex lube for shaving and straightening out hair. It sounds weird, but it works. Put a dab of lube on your skin and work it in gently with a bit of water. Shave up, being careful to wash the razor out immediately. If you need to straighten or tame your hair in the morning, a little bit works wonders, and it doesn't look noticeable afterwards. Shower at public swimming pools, as well as colleges and universities. If you pretend to be a student, colleges often won't ask you to show your ID. This won't work all the time, but it's worth the try, especially if you trick a regular into believing you belong there. 7. Decide what happens when you run out of food. Come up with a plan, and if you run out of suitable options, consider returning home, or if you're really true about running away, try to start a new life. Get a job, some shelter, no matter how bad, all you need is protection from the weather, and some friends in your new city or town. 8. Control any desperation productively. When you're down on your luck and you have nowhere else to turn, you can begin to feel pretty desperate. Try to control that emotion instead of letting it push you to do rash things. Get some good food into your stomach, even if it means spending every penny you have. Take a deep breath, even if it feels like wasting time. Think back to a time when you felt powerful and resourceful, ready to take on the world. Control your desperation by controlling your attitude. There is no problem that can't be tackled by a little bit of imagination and pluck. Part 4. Protecting yourself from harm. Download article. 1. Avoid hitchhiking. Keep in mind, if you do decide to hitchhike, that there are drivers that will do some bad things to you. They could abandon you or even hurt you. However, on the flip side, there are also really nice people out there who would gladly take you with them. It's all about reading the driver and making a decision. Try to hitch rides with a nice lady, a family with several children, or a car with passengers. They will probably want to ask you where you are going, or what you are doing, so have a nice little lie handy. Do not tell them that you ran away from home, and say as little to them as possible. If a sketchy or scary looking person offers to give you a ride, ask them where they're going first. When they answer, tell them you're going to a different place, preferably far away. If they say that they can take you there, politely refuse and cut off communication after that. Wait for them to drive off. 2. Protect yourself. If you are in a big city with many people, know that there are likely people who could pose a threat to you. Bring something with which you can defend yourself, such as pepper spray, cleaning chemicals, or perfume, because perfume contains chemicals that can cause blindness. Being aware of dangers and avoiding them is usually better than having to confront them, however. Walk away from people who pose a threat to you. Stand upright and tall, and keep your composure, but don't argue or aggravate them. Try to get to a public, well-lit area where there are a lot of people. There's usually strength in numbers. 3. Don't get pulled into prostitution. Don't let anyone do anything to you that you are uncomfortable with. If you get desperate enough that you feel you need to resort to this, seek help. Local charities and churches will help you without asking too many questions. Prostitution is a common outcome of running away. Actually, a study showed that 1 in 4 of runaways, both boys and girls, were victims of trafficking or used sex to get things like food and shelter. 5. Because of the high chance of prostitution and also because of the poor sanitation conditions, runaways are significantly more likely to get HIV/AIDS. Be very careful. 4. Avoid drugs and alcohol. Homeless youth are significantly more likely to fall into drug and / alcohol use. This can lead to diseases like HIV/AIDS or even death from overdose. This is just aside from the other side effects of drug and / alcohol use. Be careful and do not use drugs, no matter how bad you feel. 5. Try to avoid getting arrested. Homeless people are much more likely to be arrested, usually for being a nuisance, loitering, or trespassing. You want to avoid having to spend a lot of time in jail. So be careful where you go and how you look and act. 6. Be careful around the other homeless people. Many people are homeless because they have mental illness and / or other chronic illness / disabilities and have been unable to get treatment. Due to poverty, especially in the US, where mental health care is notoriously inadequate, and they lack public health care, and these people can be perfectly wonderful. There are also people who are dangerous. Try to avoid being around other homeless people to keep yourself safe. Community Q&A. Question. Is money really essential to run away? Community answer. Yes. You need it to pay for things like public transport, food, and entering some public places. For example, public pools or gyms. In addition, costs can come up when you don't expect them to, like having to pay money to stay a night in a homeless shelter, or losing your water bottle and having to buy a new one. Being without money is going to make survival and getting around, as well as many emergency situations, much, much harder. Not helpful 105, helpful 996. Question. Can I still go to school if I run away from home? Community answer. You can go to school, but it is likely that your teachers or administrators will report your presence and return you back home. Not helpful 423, helpful 2822. Question. What if it is temporary so that I can see how much they really miss me? Community answer. Don't run away solely to gauge the reactions of your family. Running away is not something to be taken lightly. You can easily get into unsafe situations and potentially end up dead or permanently traumatized, which really isn't worth just trying to see if your family would miss you. If you're struggling with your family situation and feel rejected or unloved, talk to them about it using I statements, or if that's really not possible, seek out the help of a trusted adult or mental health professional, especially if you're being abused. There are undoubtedly other options to solve the situation that don't involve putting yourself in danger. Not helpful 265, helpful 925. See more answers. Ask a question. Submit tips. Talk to yourself. Do you really have to run away? Do you have a higher chance of survival at home or in a faraway place? Is there someone else you can stay with, such as a trusted grandparent? Don't make harsh decisions in a hurry. There are other options for young people. Visit http://www.1800runaway.org or call 1-800-786-2929, 1-800-RUNAWAY, to talk about your specific situation and options you have. If your situation is abusive, dysfunctional, related to substance issues, related to your relationship, or anything else, it's good to have someone to talk to before going on your own. Wear a cap or something that reasonably covers your head / face when traveling, because CCTV footage will be checked. Use the COVID-19 pandemic to your advantage and wear face masks often. Show more tips. Warnings. Exercise common sense. By running away, you can face the risk of getting caught, mugged, raped, kidnapped, or murdered. It is something you might regret for the rest of your life. Be prepared for when you run out of food and money, because there will be a time when that happens. Be careful if you hide out at another person's home because your hosts can be charged with harboring a runaway. Do not run away unless it is essential. Try seeing if you can stay at a friend's house first. It is extremely dangerous to be alone on the streets, so please use this as a last resort. Remember that, regardless of how successful you are in running away, you will likely end up returning home eventually. Remember, if you do return home and your parents may abandon you, then go to your friend's house. Do not bring your cell phone with you, as it can be used to trace your location. If you need to make a call to someone, borrow a phone or use a payphone. If you need to purchase something, try to pay with cash. Leaving behind family that loves you is the hardest part, so be sure that you are, if you insist on running away, in fact doing so for the right reason and not just because you want attention. Be ready to cut off any romantic relationships. Don't think you can keep your boyfriend/girlfriend if you run away from home. Know that running away from home can cause more grief to your parents and siblings than you can ever imagine. If you are punished and don't think it's fair, just think about what you did and how many times you did it. Also, remember the good times you've had with your family. You may forgive them and not run away at all. Things you'll need: medication/bandages, bring meds for sickness only. Coat. Money, preferably $50 or more. Food, non-perishable. If you bring some fruit or bread, make sure to eat it in the first 2 weeks. Clothing, at least 2 outfits. Water, keep the bottle to refill. You can fill it up whenever you come to a stream or water fountain to save money. Flashlight, with an extra pair of batteries. Matches/lighters. Blankets. Pocket knife, only use if needed. Deodorant. Toothbrush/toothpaste. Toilet paper. Entertainment, a book, a handheld game console, or a laptop with a place to charge it. If you do decide to bring something electronic, make sure you always keep it with you, so it doesn't get stolen. Map. How to have a healthy sex life, teens. Download article. Parts. 1. Learning about safe sex. 2. Having sex. 3. Having a non-penetrative sex life. Plus show 1 more. Other sections. Expert Q&A. Related articles. References. Article summary. Co-authored by Nicole Moore. Last updated, the 14th of June, 2024. Approved. Sex or sexual experiences can be a great part of your relationship, an enjoyable one-time experience, or something you're saving for later. No matter which you choose, this is a major decision that you and your partner should make together on equal footing. And while it's no one's favorite topic, you must be mature enough to face the risk of STDs, as well as the possible decision to raise a child, abort a pregnancy, or give up a child for adoption if you have to. 1. Part 1. Learning about safe sex. Download article. 1. Understand pregnancy. Every teen should educate themselves about pregnancy before any sexual activity that involves PIV sex. 2. Here are a few basics that sexually active people should know about pregnancy. Pregnancy can occur any time that semen enters the vagina. Almost all pregnancies result from unprotected penetrative sex, with the penis in the vagina. Pregnancy cannot occur between two vulva owners. Not just cisgender women get pregnant when a person with a penis ejaculates inside a person's vagina, they can get pregnant, whether they are trans, non-binary, cisgender, or something else. Pregnancy is not possible with oral sex, anal sex, or non-penetrative sexual activities. 3. Semen must enter the vagina to cause pregnancy. 4. Precum, a fluid the penis releases in small amounts when aroused, typically does not contain viable sperm. Unlike semen, precum is unlikely to cause pregnancy, but there is a small risk. 5. 2. 2. Learn about sexually transmitted diseases. All types of unprotected vaginal, oral, and anal sex can spread sexually transmitted diseases, STDs. 6. You can only get an STD by sharing fluids or skin-to-skin contact with someone already infected. However, most people infected with an STD have no symptoms, they are asymptomatic, but can still transmit the disease and cause major health problems, such as infertility and cancer, down the road. The U.S. Center for Disease Control recommends annual STD testing. 7. People with penises who do not have sex. With people with penises are at lower risk, but should still be tested, especially after risky sexual behavior. Some STDs can take 6 months or longer to show up on a test. 8. This is known as an incubation period and it varies with which STD and test used. If you and your sexual partner only have sex with each other, you only need to be tested once, although it doesn't hurt to get tested regularly. Get tested again if you suspect your partner has had sex with someone else, or if either of you have used injected drugs with a shared needle. Everyone should get the HPV9, hepatitis A, and hepatitis B vaccines before becoming sexually active. If you get vaccinated after being infected with these viruses, vaccines will not be effective in treating the conditions. 3. 3. Use condoms when having penis in vagina sex. Condoms are the most common method of birth control among teens. They are cheap, easy to use, and protect you from both pregnancy and some sexually transmitted diseases. Make sure you are using them correctly. Male condoms reduce pregnancy chance to 2% per year when used perfectly, but during typical use, mistakes or lapses increases this to 15%. 9. Female condoms /internal condoms are slightly less effective, reducing the chance to 5% when used correctly. 10. Do not use a female, internal, and male external condom at the same time. Using condoms and one of the methods below is an excellent way to protect yourself and your sexual partner. 4. 4. Consider birth control pills if you can get pregnant. 11. Birth control pills are very effective at preventing pregnancy when a female takes one every day. 12. They do not protect against any STDs. The pill is available over the counter in many countries. In the US, you need a doctor's prescription. US law prevents your doctor from telling your parents /guardian about your birth control. However, they may find out if you pay for it using your parents' health insurance. Birth control typically costs US $15.50 per month, so you and your sexual partner may be able to pay for it yourselves. 13. These pills are very safe for most people but may cause health issues if you have serious health issues related to your heart or blood. Smoking increases this risk. Learn about the pros and cons before taking them. Birth control pills make your menstrual cycle more regular and may reduce unpleasant side effects, such as acne and cramping. 5. Track the female fertility cycle. People with vaginas, and not on FTM hormones, are most fertile during ovulation and for a few days afterward. This usually happens on days 11-21 of a 28-day menstrual cycle, where day 1 is the start of menstrual flow. 14. It's important to realize that most people do not have regular cycles, so you can't predict exactly when this happens in advance. This tells you when pregnancy is especially risky, but you shouldn't skip protection at other times of the month. Sperm can survive for a few days in the vagina, so if you're sex with somebody with a penis and you have a vagina, sex before ovulation can still lead to pregnancy. To track this, keep a menstrual cycle calendar with signs of an approaching period. If you want to be extra safe, track your ovulation. 6. Research other forms of birth control. There are many other forms of birth control available, from diaphragms to intrauterine devices. For more information, visit a reproductive health center such as Planned Parenthood, or talk to a doctor or gynecologist. Teens are exposed to many myths about birth control and STDs, so don't assume everything you've heard is true. 15. The withdrawal method, where a person with a penis pulls out before ejaculation in somebody with a vagina, is not recommended by most experts. While it does reduce pregnancy somewhat when followed correctly, there is a risk they will not pull out in time, or change their mind after sex has started. This method also offers no protection against STDs. 16. Part 2. Having sex. Download article. 1. Decide whether you're ready for sex. Take some time alone to think through this decision. Ideally, you should answer yes to all these questions before you have sex. 17. 18. Do you and your partner understand how pregnancy and STDs work? Can you talk openly about the risk, and agree on a method or methods of protection? Do you and your partner trust and respect each other? Would your partner listen if you changed your mind and said stop? Are your personal values compatible with the sexual experience you're considering? Would your family and community be okay with this if they knew? If you answer no, are you comfortable accepting that fact? 2. Avoid sex for the wrong reasons. Sex can be a great way for two people in a healthy relationship to have fun and express their connection. This isn't always the reason sex happens. However, be honest about why you want to have sex, and understand which reasons are no good. 19, 20, 21. Only have sex when you and your partner genuinely want to. If one of you is pressuring the other, put this to a stop and wait until both of you are ready. Don't have sex because you think everyone else is doing it. Most high school students have not had sex, and the ones that do don't have sex very often. Don't have sex to save a failing romantic relationship. It won't work. 3. talk with your partner. Once you're confident you're ready for sex, talk to your partner. 22. You need to talk about previous sexual experiences, possible STDs. 23. What to do in the event of an unplanned pregnancy, and your views on abortion and adoption, if pregnancy is possible. Tell each other why you want to have sex. If you cannot talk to your partner about these topics, you may want to postpone sex until the two of you are able to have the conversation. Make sure you're on the same page about what sex means to your relationship. Is it just for fun? Do you love each other? Is this an exclusive relationship? 4. Plan ahead. If it's the first time for one or both of you, or even just your first time with each other, you're going to need privacy and time to yourselves. Arrange your agreed-upon method, S, of protection in advance, so you don't miss an opportunity. Finding privacy can be difficult, but try not to do it in your car. This is illegal in some areas. Try to restrict yourselves to one of your homes, while there are no other people around. 5. Take your time. There is nothing worse than a rushed first time. Go slow, and explore each other's bodies. Foreplay is necessary to help you become aroused and comfortable. This is especially important for people with vaginas, as arousal causes the vagina to become lubricated. Without lubrication, penetration can cause significant pain. 6. Go as far as you are comfortable. A sexual encounter can mean playing with each other with your clothes on, helping each other masturbate, or having penetrative forward/oral sex. Enjoy each other however you both agree to. Doing something once does not mean you have to do it again. You and your partner are allowed to have a different comfort level on a different day. Emily Morse, author and sex therapist. Prioritize finding out what works for you. The best thing you can do for your sexual confidence is taking the time to learn what feels good for your body. 7. Have realistic expectations. Don't be mortified at a failure to orgasm, or at rapid ejaculation. These are common occurrences during first-time sex, or when you're feeling nervous. Also, understand what a typical sexual experience is like, instead of believing what you hear in boasts, porn, or romance novels. The typical person with a penis lasts 5 minutes during penetrative sex before ejaculating. 24. Some people with vulvas take longer to orgasm than their partner, or have trouble achieving orgasm from penile vaginal sex alone. They can still enjoy sex and may choose to orgasm through assisted masturbation or non-penetrative sex. 8. Let each other change your mind. If you want to slow down or stop, say so. There's nothing wrong with feeling nervous or uncomfortable, or even in pain. The best way to deal with this is to take a break and go back to something you're more comfortable with. You can try again when you feel ready, whether that means in 5 minutes or next month. Continuing intercourse with a partner who asks you to stop is morally wrong, even if it began as consensual sex. In many regions, this is legally considered rape or sexual assault. 9. Talk about the experience with your partner afterwards. Did you enjoy yourselves? Was there anything that you especially enjoyed, or that made you uncomfortable? the more you can talk about it, the more comfortable you'll be with each other, and the more enjoyable your next sexual experience will be, if you decide to do it again. 10. 10. Understand healthy anal sex. Among some heterosexual teenage groups, most anal sex happens when men pressure or coerce women into trying it. 25. Do not try anal sex if you do not want to. Understand that it is generally more painful than vaginal sex. Relaxation exercises and water-based lubrication can improve the experience. 26. Roughly 10% of straight couples and 66% of male gay couples in the UK practice anal sex regularly. Part 3. Having a non-penetrative sex life. Download article. 1. 1. Don't engage in sexual intercourse. You've determined that you enjoy being sexual with your partner, but are still not ready to have intercourse. Perhaps you're just not ready now, or you may have decided that you want to wait until marriage before you engage in sexual intercourse. If you are avoiding sex for religious or cultural reasons, understand that some of the practices in this section may be considered sex by your religion /culture's standards. 2. 2. Engage in heavy petting. What is it? Heavy petting is erotic contact between two people that stops short of penetrative sex, vaginal, anal, or oral. The risk of disease and pregnancy are greatly reduced, though there is still a very small risk in either case, depending on the level of intimate contact. 3. 3. Engage in non-penetrative sex. This can range from all clothes on dry humping to all clothes off touching sessions, including mutual masturbation and sexual satisfaction. Because orgasm is generally part of the process, it's safe to say this is sexual activity, and does carry a low risk of pregnancy or disease. However, neither result is likely. 27. Neither partner should feel obligated to perform other sexual acts to avoid intercourse. 4. 4. Engage in oral sex. While oral sex can be pleasurable for both partners, it is not without its risks. Pregnancy is not an issue, but disease transmission is still possible. 28. The CDC reports that over 60% of US residents between the ages of 15 and 24 have had oral sex, compared to about 50% who have had vaginal intercourse. 29. The CDC study also reports that patients visiting STD clinics have shown that 5-10% have gonorrhea in the throat, and can raise the risk for infection by chlamydia, herpes, syphilis, and cancer-causing HPV, and recommends using safe sex techniques when performing oral sex. Part 4. Practicing abstinence. Download article. 1. 1. Refrain from having sex. This may seem counterintuitive to an article on having a healthy sex life, but consider this: if 2/3 of teenagers are engaging in sex, that means 1/3 are not. Also, abstinence does not mean not feeling sexual, it means not having sex. If this is the choice you and your partner have made, then do not be ashamed of it. Neither should you be ashamed to have sexual urges with your partner, it would be unnatural not to. There are some things you can do to help calm those urges, and still share the kinds of intimacies that people in love share. 30. 2. Enjoy the makeout session but keep your limits firmly in place. If they're wandering hands, land where you don't want them, don't just try to block the move with your body language, move them away with your own hands, and say no, I'm not ready for that. They should get the idea immediately, and respect you enough to stop that approach. This can still spread STDs and bacterial infections. 3. Break off the makeout session if it gets too hot for either of you to handle. It's completely natural to feel desire, but it's not required that you act on that. If you find yourself suddenly overwhelmed with passion, but are committed to remaining chaste for now, simply back off a bit and say something like, wow, that's hot, but I'm not ready to go further right now. Let's go watch a movie. If your partner doesn't understand, or is insistent, don't be surprised, they may not be quite as ready to stop as you are, and might be a little confused and flustered. However, if they remain insistent, or demanding, or even attempt emotional blackmail such as if you loved me you would keep going, send them home to cool down, and rethink if you want to be in that situation with them again. 4. Understand the risks. Surprisingly, abstinence actually has a higher failure rate than condoms in preventing STDs and pregnancy. This doesn't mean you can get pregnant from kissing, of course. What this means is that a large number of abstaining teens lose their resolve and have some form of sex in the heat of the moment, often without protection. Educate yourself about pregnancy and STDs. Understanding these risks can help you stick to your plan, or run out and buy a condom if you change your minds. 31. Use a condom safely and effectively with this expert series. In order to have safe sex, it's important to know how to use a condom correctly. Fortunately, this expert series has everything you need to know about condoms. 1. Use a condom. 2. Use a female condom. 3. Have safer sex. 4. Check a condom. 5. Put on a condom with foreskin. 6. How to avoid awkward interactions. Expert Q&A. Question. Is it okay to be sexually active at 16? Nicole Moore. Love and relationship coach. Expert answer. Possibly, as long as you're being cautious and thinking in the long term. Consider talking to your doctor about different birth control methods, and chatting with your partner about safe sex. Always plan for health and safety instead of going with the flow and seeing what happens. Not helpful 62, helpful 142. Question. When is it normal to have sex? Ruby. Top answerer. When you are ready and you are above the age of consent. Some people want to rush into sex. But you shouldn't feel pressured. Sex is not a competition and it should only be done when it's the right time for both you and your sexual partner. Keep in mind that some people may exaggerate or lie about having sex in order to impress people. Don't worry about that and instead go at whatever pace is right for you. Not helpful 6, helpful 39. Question. Can you have sex with a tampon in? Ruby. Top answerer. This is not recommended, especially in penetrative sex. The penis can push the tampon further in, making it harder to remove. If you are on your period and want to have sex, your best bet would be to put a clean towel underneath Not helpful, too helpful. 21. See more answers. Ask a question. Submit. Tips. An LGBTQ relationship does not require one penetrative and one receptive partner. Many couples perform both roles. 32. Keep the line of communication open during sexual activities to share feelings and advice. Your partner wants to please you but needs to know what he or she should do that best serves your needs. Digital sex, fingering, is unlikely to transfer STDs. Wash your hands with soap and warm water beforehand to reduce the risk of other health problems. Submit a tip. All tip submissions are carefully reviewed before being published. Submit. Warnings. In many places, sex with someone under the local age of consent is illegal and considered statutory rape, which can be a severe criminal offense. In some jurisdictions, this is the case even if both partners are under the age of consent. Be sure to check your local laws and age of consent before you engage in sexual activity. If you don't want to get pregnant, the safest choice is to not engage in sexual intercourse. While it's not always a simple decision, it is important to know that if you do have sex with the opposite sex, pregnancy can sometimes occur even if proper precautions are taken. Setting a time limit can work against you if one of you expects to have sex once the time limit is up. Make sure that there is room for someone's mind to change. Make sure upfront that your partner completely understands that you will not engage in vaginal intercourse, if that is your decision, regardless of your gender. Never sleep with someone because they are pressuring you, because you think they'll love you, or because it's cool. It'll only lead to heartbreak. How to run away intelligently. Download article. Parts. 1. Preparing for your departure. 2. Starting your journey. 3. Surviving as a runaway. Plus show one more. Other sections. Tips and warnings. Related articles. References. Article summary. Co-authored by Sabrina Grover, LMSW. Last updated, the 23rd of May, 2024. Fact checked. Running away from home, while it sounds liberating and glamorous, is not fun. You'll be sleeping on the street, scrounging for food, and life certainly won't be easy. That being said, sometimes a home situation is so bad that running away still looks like the better option. If you've thought it through and still want to run away, but run away successfully, it's time to start getting ready. Part 1. Preparing for your departure. Download article. 1. Save up some cash. Ideally, you'll have at least $5,000 with you. That may sound like a lot, but $5,000 can seem to disappear in no time at all. The last thing you want is to realize the morning after your escape that you can't afford breakfast. If you get in a tight spot, which you likely will, you'll be glad you have the money. This is, of course, if you don't have a job and a place to stay lined up. If you're one of the lucky few who have a pre-approved destination in mind, you may be able to get by being a little more strapped for cash. It's always a good idea to have some money saved up before you leave home. 2. Practice living like a runaway. Before you actually run away, you should practice living like you've done so, especially if you want to run away intelligently. This, by and large, means 2 things. 1. Find ways to scavenge for food. whether it's seeing what a few days off the dollar menu feels like or dumpster diving practice. It's more than a good idea to see what you're in for, food and drink wise. Aside from those two ideas, we'll talk about what else you can do in the next section. Practice sleeping in uncomfortable places. When you're on the run, you'll be sleeping on benches, behind bushes, curled in corners, you name it. You won't be sleeping in your 1,000 thread count Egyptian cotton sheets anymore that your body is used to. Sleeping in hard, uncomfortable places is only difficult if you're not used to. Get used to it beforehand and it's one less thing you have to worry about. 3. If applicable, find somewhere to land. Sometimes runaways just go. That's the beauty of it. However, just going can be particularly stressful. It's better to go if you have a safe destination. You know you can, at least, hunker down in for a while until you get your own 2 feet on the ground. If you had to go somewhere else right now, where would it be? Youth shelters are a good place to start. They're not a good place to stay forever. But they can give you that time to get your situation figured out. A friend or extended family member can be good, too, but do know that puts them in a tough place when it comes to your parents. They are legally bound to say they know where you are if your parents have filed a report on your disappearance. However, you may be able to get away with a few days, no questions asked, and food on the table. 4. Pack your bag well. A good, waterproof backpack should be what you're working with. You never know if you'll get caught in the snow or rain. Inside should be a warm sleeping bag, a flashlight, spare batteries, a water bottle with a filter, storable food, a compass, lead clothing, a knife to defend yourself with, and your light valuable possessions. If you have a room, it can also be nice to have a pillow with you. Everything else will just have to go. Remember that you're taking this wherever you go, like a backpacker. It'll be annoying as much as it'll be useful. Also, remember that what you carry around determines your look. Do you look like a backpacker, tourist, or shifty runaway? 5. Leave a note. Though it may seem counterintuitive, be sure to hide a note informing the authorities of your intent to run away so they do not believe it to be a kidnapping, or worst case, murder. The authorities are going to investigate a kidnapping more thoroughly than a runaway case. Do not be afraid to hide this note fairly well, the authorities will find it during their search no matter how well it is hidden, and discovery by your guardian would likely lead to immediate notification of authorities. 6. Leave when the weather is good. If it's the dead of winter and nights reach below zero, you're as bright as Napoleon was attacking Russia in January. To give yourself a better shot, wait until the weather gets nicer. You'll be spending a large amount of time outside day and night, so it's best to have Mother Nature on your side. Sleeping inside sometimes lets us forget just how cold it gets at nights. Bring long underwear and warm clothing with you, even if you're not sure you'll need it. It's better to be safe than sorry, and warmth is a necessity. Part 2. Starting your journey. Download article. Wear sunglasses and makeup to hide your identity. Also, do not take clothes that you wear often. Blend in with the group. 1. Get on a bus or train. Once you're out of the house, whether it's after school or while the parents are asleep, get to the nearest bus or train station. Take a look at the schedule, and get one whichever one comes next. Hop on, and you're out of there. Now here's a few things to keep in mind. If you decide to travel across country borders, try to do so within the first 12 hours of departure. Your passport photo will be easily recognizable by border control after your parent has had you declared an official missing person. You are less likely to be recognized if you are not nearby your home. Although this may sound slightly crazy, it's actually easier to run away to a foreign country, especially in Europe, because you will likely be mistaken for just another American tourist with a lot of luggage. Don't talk about your story to other passengers. They may not take pity on you, and instead take pity on your parents, and alert the police to your situation. If anyone asks, either come up with a story or tell them you'd just like to keep to yourself. 2. Don't let yourself get caught electronically. Do not bring your cell phone, iPod, iPad or any other portable electronic devices with you. They can and will track you down using these devices. If you need a communication device to carry out your plans, bring enough money to buy a simple cell phone and some credit. It won't be fancy, but it'll be a number. Don't update your social media either, saying, "I'm so tired of this crap. I'm going to run away," is not a brilliant idea. What's more, never go on your old Facebook, MySpace, Twitter, YouTube, Gmail or any other web-based account again once you leave. They can easily track you using these sites. 3. If necessary, change your appearance. If you know people are searching for you and you don't want to be found, you'll need to change what you look like to raise fewer eyebrows. The easiest thing to do will be to cut and dye your hair. Wherever you do this, though it will likely be a public bathroom, be sure to clean up after yourself. In the worst case scenario, police take your hair and get your DNA from it, getting closer to your whereabouts. It's also a good idea to gain weight, if possible, within reason, of course. Losing weight is to be expected. Those looking for you will assume you're becoming thinner as the days go by because you're not eating. 4. Never try to contact friends after leaving unless you are 100% sure they will not inform the authorities. The fact of the matter is that you're going to get lonely. You're going to be tempted to call people from your past, but if you want them to stay part of your past, you can't. Only if you are absolutely, positively confident they will not inform the authorities should you even think about it. And even then, exercise caution. They may tell someone who will tell someone who will tell the authorities. The gossip chain is usually pretty hard to pin down, and it's always flowing from ear to ear somewhere. Part 3. Surviving as a runaway. Download article. 1. Find somewhere to sleep. If you don't have a bed to sleep in, which will be the case most nights, the best spots to sleep are in the bushes, at the park, or in the woods or large, empty fields. In short, being out of the city is best. However, if you're stuck there, go somewhere that's open 24 hours a day, like a train or bus station. 2. If you are in a place surrounded by people, know that you have a higher chance of police or concerned pedestrians questioning you about your predicament. Always be prepared with a backstory. Make sure that wherever you are that's empty at night is still empty in the morning. That church parking lot on Saturday evening may seem safe and secure, but come Sunday morning you'll be regretting that assumption. 2. Eat on the cheap. Food is expensive. Apart from eating cheaply at grocery stores by just buying loaves of bread, cheese, and peanut butter, you should also work eating for free into your repertoire. Here are some ideas. Dumpsters behind grocery stores and restaurants often throw out the food they can't sell. It's not necessarily old, they just can't sell it. Go at night after closing, and you may be rewarded. Poke around at buffet. When a party gets up, you go in for the pounce. Uneaten. Food for the win. Ask. If you go to a restaurant, cafe, or hospital, they may take pity on you and give you some of the food they know they probably won't or can't sell. Just remember to put on your kindest smile when you do so. 3. If possible, get a job. If you're 16 or older, you may be able to get a job and settle down in your new location. It's the best way to keep your cash flowing, and besides, you didn't want to go back home anyway, right? If you can give them a phone number, an address, and look showered, you may be in. If you're not 16 or you admitting your identity is a problem, see if you can find day-to-day, cash-in-hand work. This will likely be manual labor, but, at least, it's something. Answering flyers posted to community boards and checking sites like Craigslist are your best bets. 4. Find cheap living quarters. Essentially, you have four options: living with a friend, living on the streets, living in a youth shelter, or squatting. They all have their advantages and disadvantages. Namely, squatting is illegal. That being said, in time you'll need to find a place if you can land a job, and then find a cheap room to rent, rented by roommates, not a landlord, that's ideal. You don't want to live forever as a runaway. Whatever you do, do not steal any items from wherever you are staying. This makes you a wanted criminal, and you are now being hunted much more so than if you had just run away. Part 4. Coping with potential problems. Download article. 1. Hitchhike. Maybe you've decided that wherever you are, you can't stay. That's okay. If you're out of cash, one of your options is to hitchhike. It's illegal in many places, but sometimes you have to do what you have to do. Here are the details. 3. Position yourself near a gas station near the entrance to a freeway or highway. You will then be able to approach the drivers that you think may give you a ride. Young and old people are best, avoid those in suits and those that look crazy. If that's not an option, get near the on-ramp or a low-speed road. The drivers need time to see you and slow down. When someone does stop, act approachable, happy, and comfortable with your situation. And then survey them. Do you want to ride with them? Trust your gut. If it says no, politely decline. If it says yes, get in, put your bag in the back, and keep your hands on your knees, to show that you're not a threat. 2. Or jump trains. Don't want to hitchhike, eh? Then your next free transport method of travel is jumping trains. It's not relaxing, but it can get you from point A to point B. Here's how to get started. 4. Go to your local train station and get a copy of the schedule. Find the train you want to take to your preferred destination. When it arrives, get on a middle car. When an agent steps away from the door, sit down as if you came from a prior stop, and keep an eye out for the agent. When you see him or her coming for your ticket, hop into the bathroom. If he or she actually knocks on the bathroom, be on the toilet and none too happy about being intruded upon. Your only other option is wandering about the entire time, never really sitting down. 3. Prepare yourself against getting robbed. The world isn't a very friendly place, especially when your peers are the ones that live on the street, too. If you act afraid and make yourself a target, you may find yourself the victim of a petty crime and without all your cash and belongings. Keep these points in mind. 5. Act confident wherever you go. Being nervous invites those looking for prey to come up to you and take advantage of you. Carry a knife with you for self-defense. It's not pretty advice, but it's real. Use a secret compartment in your backpack, if possible. If they raid your stuff, they may skip over the lining of your bag. You can keep a small laptop or something flat in there to mirror the structure of the bag. There's such a thing as adventure underwear and it has pockets. Thieves will generally not check your underwear, so keeping a wad of cash in there is a pretty safe bet. 4. If you are in a public area, walk into the nearest store. Chances are they won't follow. 5. Know your legal situation. If you live in the States, it is illegal to run away from home under the age of 18 in Georgia, Idaho, Kentucky, Nebraska, South Carolina, Texas, Utah, West Virginia, and Wyoming. If you get caught or return home, you may be facing a penalty. In other countries, it varies by jurisdiction. And even if it is not illegal, you generally do not have rights if found and will be escorted home, even if it is against your will. It's important to go in with this knowledge so you know what you're in for. If you have run away several times, you may become a child of the state and be forced into the foster system, or otherwise away from your home when found. You are then deemed a child in need of supervision and the courts will determine what to do with you. Because of situations like this, it's best to avoid the authorities at all costs. If you are in a foreign country that speaks a different language and you get confronted by the police, pretend not to speak English. It really helps to be bilingual in this situation, even if it is a language different than the native one of the country you're in, to try to fool the police into thinking you are from a country other than your actual homeland. 6. Call a runaway hotline. If worst comes to worst, you can always call a runaway hotline in your country. They can either set you up temporarily at a shelter or even pay for your ticket home, bus, or train, usually. They also offer counsel and can be an understanding ear should you need one. In the US, that number is 1-800-RUNAWAY. In the UK, Childline offers similar services at 0800-1111. Covenant House, based in Los Angeles but operating in many countries in North America and Central America, offers shelter to youth. And their main number is 323-461-3131. 6. Expert Q&A. Ask a question. Submit. Tips. Try to make new friends with your new name after leaving to erase any feelings of loneliness. You may want to alert your parents that you are still alive after you reach the age of 18, as you will still be an official missing person until you do so. If you are running away to a foreign country, make sure it is a safe one. If you are a 15-year-old girl, running away to Ciudad Juarez is not the smartest thing you could do. You should also try to make sure you speak the country's language. Show more tips. Tips from our readers. Another place to hide money and documents is under the insoles of your shoes. When I travel, I always keep emergency cash and copies of my passport there. Use the COVID-19 pandemic to your advantage. If you wear a face mask as well as a hoodie, you won't be as recognizable. How to run away from home as a teen. Download article. Methods. 1. Evaluating your situation. 2. Preparing to leave. 3. Living away from home. Other sections. Tips and warnings. Things you all need. Related articles. References. Article summary. Author info. Last updated, the 28th of July, 2024. References. Running away is the last resort that should only be attempted in the direst of situations. In many cases, running away can make whatever problem you are trying to escape even worse. If you want to run away, be sure to pack stuff that you need, so you don't go starving and or don't get in danger. You also have to be very smart and probably learn to survive alone on the streets. It will be also hard to find a place to stay. For example, search up ways to live on the streets, or what happens on the streets. Be sure you have exhausted every option available to you before you consider running away. And if this is the only option available to you, do not make any hasty decisions. Your safety should always be your number one priority. Remember to keep all variables in mind as you read this article. If you're considering running away or have already run away and need some help, read on. Method 1. Evaluating your situation. Download article. 1. 1. Have a good reason for leaving. Do not run away for kicks, adventure, or to teach your parents a lesson. 1. Living on the streets is difficult, and nature will not provide you with blankets when you are cold or food when you are hungry. If you are being abused or neglected, the safest solution is to call Children's Aid or the police before trying to run away. Some teens, especially those with troubled families, think that foster care is worse than running away. Whatever your experience may be, the majority of foster parents truly care about the health and well-being of their foster children. 2. 2. Don't hold false perceptions. Running away from home is hard. You will be separated from the places you are familiar with and the people who know and support you, and you will be completely responsible for satisfying all your basic needs. 2. Even adults struggle with daily life. Don't think this will be any different for you. 3. You may feel like running away is your only solution, but this kind of thinking is never accurate. 4. There are always many solutions to a problem, and running away should be a last resort. As a teen, it will be difficult for you to make money to pay for food and shelter. Unfortunately, because of this reason, around 1 in 3 teens who run away resort to trading sexual favors for food or a place to stay. 5. This will put you at risk for sexually transmitted diseases, sexual abuse, and / or manipulation. 3. Evaluate your reason, S, for leaving. You may believe that your reason, S, for running away from home are strong justifications for wanting to do so. However, when you feel strongly about something, it can be difficult to think clearly. 6. Take time to carefully think about why you want to run away. Get as much perspective on your issue as you can. Be sure you are not making a hasty decision. It is never okay to run away because of your alcohol use, drug use, feelings of failure. 4. Consider getting anonymous advice. There are hotlines available for teens in difficult situations, and these are well equipped to listen to your problem and offer specific advice to you. There may be solutions to your problem that you haven't considered that are safer than running away, and talking to someone can help you figure these solutions out. 7. The National Runaway Safeline is open 24/7. You can call for advice at 1-800-786-2929 or visit the Safeline website at http://www.1800runaway.org. Remember that no matter how difficult your situation or how alone you feel, there are people who care deeply about your safety and well-being. 5. Realize the nature of your problem. The running away might remove you from the problem you are facing. It will not solve it or make you feel better about the way you've been treated. 8. By running away, you may cause whatever is happening to you to shift to someone else, such as a sibling who cares for you. Method 2. Preparing to leave. Download article. 1. Plan ahead. Running away without proper preparation can put your life in danger. Take as much time as you need to figure out a game plan. Where you are going, transportation, work, and shelter are all important to consider. Gather supplies beforehand, some of which might include cash, change for the laundromat, first aid kit, coat, sleeping bag, socks, change of clothes, x2, change of underwear /bra, x2, toothbrush /paste, tampons /pads, hairbrush, water bottle, non-perishable food, granola bars, canned food, pepper spray, deodorant, 9. 2. Travel light. Carrying a heavy load can slow you down if you need to move quickly. As a teen runaway, many other homeless people will be bigger and stronger than you, and if you need to escape, you need to do so quickly, without being bogged down by creature comforts. Only pack necessities. Take as much cash as you are able, but be wary of credit or debit cards, which can be tracked. Pack for your destination. If you are heading somewhere cold, your greatest concern should be keeping warm. Keep in mind that arid climates, like the desert, get very cold after dark. A lightweight thermal blanket could save your life. 3. Choose to run to a safe location. Staying in a forest, park, or nature preserve is not recommended. All it takes is a bad step and you may be stranded with a broken ankle far from medical help. If you want to live in the country, be sure to travel along main routes where you can flag down help if needed. If you live in a city or are running to an urban area, try to find a shelter. If you don't have any safe options, try to rest in a busy place during the day. Sleep on a blanket in the park or at the beach during the day. This will make you look less suspicious and more like a normal person taking a nap. A location with public transportation is a good choice, as it is cheaper and faster than other options. A bicycle can be useful, but its weight and safety can be a bigger hassle than help. Bridges offer protection from the elements and the cement will hold warmth from the day through the night. Beware of others if you attempt sleeping under a bridge. These are popular locations for other homeless people. If you chose to go to a homeless shelter, you must be prepared to answer questions when you arrive. A friend or a relative's house should be considered but will come with its own rules. You will always have to respect the homes of others. 4. Find a place to get the help you need. The most important thing you can do after you escape your situation is get to a place of wellness. Whatever trauma made you leave home in the first place, there will likely be some resulting issues you'll need to address before you can start living a healthy and happy life. 10. 11. Before you leave, do some research on the area you are running away to, and find halfway homes, detox centers, or counseling centers so you can get yourself the help you need. If you have turned to drugs or alcohol as a way of coping with the things you have suffered, this will eventually cause even greater harm to you physically and emotionally. You are not to blame. Whatever you have suffered has pushed you into a vulnerable place. However, you cannot truly be well on your own until you address and resolve your addictions or dependencies. 12. 5. 5. Consider making an anonymous tip. Even if you've made up your mind to never return home, there may be other people suffering from the same abuse or neglect that you did. Especially if you have siblings, please consider making an anonymous call or tip to the police or child protective services in your state, talking with child help from a public phone, or using a friend's phone. Child Helpline, 800-422-4453. 6. 6. Think ahead about work. As a teen, even working at a fast food establishment will require you to have parental consent along with other necessary information, like an address and your social security number. Eventually, you will run out of supplies and money. You will need a source of income to support yourself. When applying for a job, hint that you are looking to make some extra money working under the table, which means you will be paid directly by your employer secretly, usually in cash. Some under-the-table work options you can consider: busboy, restaurant, dishwasher, landscaping forward / gardening, tutor, babysitter, mover, painter. Method 3. Living away from home. Download article. 1. 1. Escape your situation. Leave when you won't be seen and be sure you won't be immediately noticed. For example, you may want to call into school sick and leave on your way, or you might consider leaving right after everyone is in bed. This will give you a few hours to put distance between you and the place you are running from. Try to make it as far away as possible before stopping to rest. To make yourself more difficult to find, You should try to get out of town, and eventually, your state. 13. The train or a bus can take you a great distance for a small cost. Wear a cap with a brim or a hood so that your face is covered and you do not show up on security footage. To make yourself less noticeable, dye your hair a common color that's different from your natural shade and forward slash or cut your hair. Be sure your new haircut forward slash dye job doesn't look sloppy. Some might question your appearance if you aren't careful. Take clothes you rarely or never wear. You can always purchase new clothing cheap from a thrift store so you aren't wearing anything that can identify you. 2. Always put food first. This is your top priority. You can fill up a bottle of water at nearly any sink. But beware labels that say not potable, as this means the water isn't intended for drinking. Take all food you find, but make sure it is good to eat, and all food offered to you, and be sure to eat it before it goes bad, even if you aren't hungry. However, never take food from some place or someone that doesn't look or isn't reputable or trustworthy. If someone or some place looks suspicious, or if food smells or looks suspicious, take the food, but when the person leaves, toss it away. Don't refuse it or toss it away in their sight because they might hurt you if you do so. Trust your instincts. If something doesn't feel right, it probably isn't. For example, if you are given some spinach and you feel a sick feeling in your stomach as you look at it, do not eat it. Or if someone or some place looks reputable or safe, but you feel suspicious, don't eat the offered gift. Some people can and will give you poisoned food and drinks. Never, under any circumstances, drink any liquids offered to you. They may be spiked or contain poison. Only drink water from water fountains where the water is good to drink. 3. Practice good hygiene. This is especially important when you start looking for work, but will also keep you from getting picked up by police for vagrancy, homelessness. Stay away from dangerous places where robbers or rapists could be lurking, which includes alleys or secluded areas of parks. Although cleanliness is important, try to look as sexually unappealing as you can to protect yourself from predators. Dress like you are going to school or an informal church event, not like you are going to a party. Clothing with lots of pockets will provide you with places to keep the necessary supplies. 4. Never resort to prostitution or to using alcohol forward slash drugs. Don't let anyone pay you for sex. This could result in you getting hurt, robbed, or the person might even refuse to pay you after finishing with you. The person may wait until you are vulnerable before asking you to go farther than you are comfortable. Your money will be necessary to pay for things you need to survive. Do not waste any of your limited cash on alcohol, drugs, or cigarettes. Although other runaways forward slash homeless may abuse drugs or alcohol, and may even offer you some, always refuse the offer. It will be difficult for you to defend yourself when drunk, high, or incapacitated. 5. Determine places you can take care of your needs. Private forward slash public restrooms, while not the most comfortable, are good places you can groom yourself. Have an answer ready for anyone who questions you. Something like, I've been traveling with my mom all day to get to my grandparents' house and we stopped here to freshen up might prevent the police from being called on you. Ladies can use Nair to remove hair and maintain appearances. Try not to look suspicious when taking care of your bathroom routine. 6. Maintain your safety. There are many tools you can use to keep safe, like a rape whistle, pepper spray, or a multi-tool, which can be used both for protection and in emergencies. Keep your tool well hidden but within reach at all times. Money should be kept in your underwear, not in socks or bras, which is where many people first look. 14. If someone says, "I saw you with money last night," say that it's all gone, even if you still have some. Keep a spare, visible bag or purse with a few dollars and coins. This way, if you're robbed, they'll take this instead. 16. If you run out of money for food, be careful when begging. This will draw attention, and in some cases, upset other homeless. It is also illegal to beg for money in some places. A supermarket that offers free samples is a great place you can find food without drawing attention to yourself. If someone asks, you can always say you're waiting for your mom. 7. Do not steal. This is not only illegal and immoral, but it will draw the attention of others, including the police. Stealing can result in even more serious consequences than simply being returned from where you have run. 8. Have answers to questions. People will likely ask questions if they see you around when school is in session or brushing your teeth in a public restroom. Don't respond to these with the first thing that comes to mind. Come up with a story explaining your situation and stick to it. This will prevent inconsistencies that will make people question you. Think ahead of time about what people might say in response to your story so you are prepared with a believable response. 9. Do not use your cell phone. This can be used to locate you after you've run away, but in an emergency, it can save your life. Keeping your cell phone turned off will prevent you from being tracked, or you can replace your SIM card. 17. Expert Q&A. Ask a question. Submit additional resources. Organization phone number. Teen line, 800-852-8336. National Runaway Safe Line, 800-786-2929. Child Help, 800-422-4453. The Trevor Project, LGBTQ, 866-488-7386. The National Domestic Violence Hotline, 800-799-7233. Tips. Only run away if you have no other alternative. This decision can have a serious and permanent negative impact on your life. You can be hurt or even killed away from the protection of your community, friends, and family. If you're being abused, call the police. If you have good wilderness survival skills, pack a portable shelter and any essentials, and camp out in the great outdoors for a while. This is not a permanent solution though. Don't fidget, stutter, or hesitate when lying. This may cause people to not believe what you are saying. Show more tips. Tips from our readers. If a sibling or friend is in a similar situation as you, run away with them. This way, if anyone gets suspicious about you being without an adult, you can say something like, My friend and I are waiting for my mom to pick us up. Having a buddy also keeps you company and helps you defend yourself, if needed. Before you leave, have at least one backup plan in case your original plan backfires. Have multiple routes to get out and bring a map with you, too. Submit a tip. All tip submissions are carefully reviewed before being published. Submit. Warnings. Always have appropriate clothing. Bring a warm, sturdy jacket, sturdy footwear, boots /sneakers, and also hot weather clothes. Don't bring weapons or look-alike weapons. Bring pepper spray instead. Weapons are illegal to carry around and someone will report you to the police if you have one. The police will think you are a smuggler, murderer, or just a criminal. Try to find somewhere safe to stay at night. You don't want to wander around at night, as there is a higher chance you may run into a criminal. If you resort to a runaway shelter, they will contact your parents if they recognize you. It's best to go to a shelter outside your city so no one will recognize you. Exercise common sense. By running away, you can face the risk of getting caught, mugged, raped, kidnapped, or murdered. It is something you might regret for the rest of your life. Don't become too confident. Overconfidence can make you an easy target and will also make you easier to find. Unless you're running from an abusive home, in which case you should call the police. Leave a note so your parents don't think you've been abducted. Keep it simple, only stating that you've run away. Things you'll need. Cash. Change for laundromat. First aid kit. Coat. Sleeping bag. Socks. Change of clothes, x2. Changes of underwear /bra, x4. Toothbrush /paste. Tampons /pads. Hairbrush. Water bottle. Non-perishable foods. Pepper spray. Deodorant. Lighter /matches, optional. Flashlight, extra batteries. Shampoo and conditioner in one, optional. Wash cloth, optional. Small travel pillow, optional. Razor /shaver /nair, optional. Notebook and pencils /pens, optional. Umbrella. List of people you trust phone numbers. Note from parents /legal guardians to show people if suspicious. Health for teens and kids. Emotional health and well-being. How to be a good boy. Download article. Co-authored by Ashley Pritchard, Ma. Last updated, the 15th of July, 2024 approved. Being a good boy at home. Being a good boy at school. Being a good boy with others. Tips. Warnings. Being a good boy is not always easy, especially if you are having trouble being good at both home and school. The most important thing is that you treat your family members, teachers, and the people around you with kindness and respect. Being a good boy doesn't mean you have to be perfect, but it does mean that you should show compassion and understanding toward others. Part 1. Being a good boy at home. Download article. 1. Listen to your parents. The best thing you can do to be a good boy at home is to listen to what your parents tell you to do. If they ask you to help out, to turn down your music, or to join them for dinner with your aunt and uncle, then you should do as they say as much as possible. Of course, if their demands are completely unreasonable, then you should have a nice, open conversation with them, but as a rule of thumb, you can be a good boy and make your parents happy by listening to what they tell you to do. 1. If your grandparents or other adults live in your home, then you should listen to them, too. When your parents are talking to you, make sure you look them in the eye and that you put away your phone. Make them see that you really care. 2. Help out around the house. If you want to be a good boy, then you should help clean up messes instead of creating them. Work to clean up after yourself, do your own laundry, and help your parents with daily tasks like throwing out the trash, taking the dog for a walk, wiping down the kitchen table, or anything else that you can do to lighten the load. If you have required chores, then you should do them without grumbling and even go above and beyond when it comes to housework. You shouldn't have to ask if you need to help or what you can do. Instead, be observant and look around to see what really needs to be cleaned up or fixed. From a sink of overflowing dishes to a hamper of clean laundry that needs to be folded. 3. Respect your siblings. Another way to be a good boy is to be nice to your siblings, whether they are older or younger. If you're the older sibling, you should serve a role model for your siblings and should help them grow more mature and reasonable as they get older. If you're a younger sibling, then you should be nice and avoid taunting or teasing your older siblings too much and let them have their own space. 3. Being a good sibling is an important part of being a good boy, and you should try to get along with your siblings as much as you can. 4. You should also help your parents out by spending time with your siblings so they don't always have to watch over them. If your siblings are upset, help them sort their problems out when you can so your parents can have some time to themselves. Avoiding fights with your siblings will help you be a good boy because you'll be helping make things easier around the house. 4. Obey the rules. Another thing you can do to be a good boy is to obey the rules your parents have set forward. This can mean sticking to your curfew, waking up at a certain time, doing the chores you were meant to do, cleaning up after yourself, only spending a certain amount of time on your phone or computer, and so on. If you want to be a good boy, then you should obey the rules you are given and only question them if you really think you need to talk to your parents about it. Disregarding your parents' rules shows them that you don't respect or care for them as much as you could. You have to show them how much you appreciate their parenting by listening to them. If you have siblings, it's important to follow your parents' rules so that you set a good example for your brother or sister. 5. Apologize when you have made a mistake. Being a good boy doesn't mean being perfect all the time. It does, however, mean that you should apologize when you feel like you've made a mistake. If you want to be a good boy, then you have to learn when you have done something wrong and be ready to admit it. 5. To truly apologize, look your parents and siblings in the eyes and give them a sincere and honest apology to show that you've put a lot of thought into what you've done and that you won't do it again. Don't just say you're sorry while you're doing something else or heading out the door. Take the time to sit down with your parents and take the time to let them know you really messed up. 6. Make your parents' lives easier. The best thing you can do as a good boy is to make your parents' lives easier. This can mean doing extra chores when you're not asked, being extra obedient on days when you can see that your parents are extra tired, spending time with your siblings to give your parents more time off, or even giving your parents space when they're tired and want to lie down. Most parents are overwhelmed by their parenting duties, and if you try to make their lives easier instead of creating problems, then they will be grateful to you for it. As you get older, you can help them run more errands, like picking up a few groceries, washing the car at home, shoveling snow, mowing the lawn, or helping get your younger siblings ready for school. If you are good at snow shoveling, you can even make legitimate money by doing it for your neighbors. If you see that your parents come home upset, try helping cook dinner or ask if you can pick up some pizza to make things easier. Expert tip. Mosh Ratson, MFT, PCC. Marriage and Family Therapist. Even small gestures can make a difference. For example, you could offer to help your parents with a difficult task to show that you care. 7. Learn more skills to help out around the house. You may think that there's only so much you can do because you're too young to really help out, but you can always learn more ways to help. If your parents do your laundry or wash your dishes for you, learn to do it yourself. If your parents always take care of the dog or cat, you should learn when they need to be fed and when to take out the dog. You can even learn to cook simple things, or to make yourself sandwiches for lunch, so your parents don't have to do it. 6. Don't think that you can't really help because you're too young. Instead, be a good boy and always look out for new ways to help out. 8. Find hobbies that help you improve yourself. Another way to be a good boy is to work on becoming a smarter, more interesting person. This can mean spending more time reading and writing, teaching yourself a foreign language, learning a skill such as soccer or playing guitar, and generally caring about self-improvement. 7. Though watching TV or playing games online can make for a fun break, you should attempt to grow as a person as much as you can if you want to be a good boy. Part of being a good boy means becoming more mature and growing as a person. Learning new skills and educating yourself can help you become a more thoughtful, well-rounded individual. 9. Don't disobey your parents in public. Another way to be a good boy is to make sure to listen to your parents in public. Avoid contradicting them, ignoring them, openly disregarding their rules, throwing tantrums, or doing anything that would make them feel embarrassed and disappointed in you. If you disagree with them about something, bring it up later, when you're alone at home, so you can have a productive conversation with them instead of throwing a fit. Even if you really, really want something your parents won't give you right then, you should avoid embarrassing or making them feel bad. This will make them upset and can hurt your relationship with them. Instead, do the mature thing and avoid throwing a tantrum and ask if you can talk about it later. Valamar Argosy Hotel. Valamar Argosy Hotel. Sponsored by Jet 2 Holidays. Book now. Part 2. Being a good boy at school. Download article. 1. Listen to your teachers. One of the best ways to be a good boy is to listen to your teachers. You should respect them and recognize that they're just people, too, and that it's rude and unkind to ignore them, be mean to them, or question their authority. Pay attention, stay calm, and show that you are engaged in what they are saying. Make an effort to do as your teachers say and not to cause problems in the classroom. Not only will listening to your teachers make them happier, but it will make your parents happier, too. If you really struggle with listening to your teachers or think they are being completely unreasonable, then you should be as nice as you can to them and talk to your parents to discuss next steps. 8. 2. 2. Do as well as you can in school. You don't need to get perfect grades to do well in school. However, you should make an effort to do as well as you can, to study for your exams, to do your homework, and to generally be a dedicated student. When you need help, come to your teachers or your parents for help, and make an effort to always improve. Good boys tend to do well in school, because they know that success in the classroom is important. Make an effort to study for your exams well in advance so you get the best results. 9. What's most important is that you respect the idea of education and come into school on time and are happy to be there. 3. 3. Be kind to your classmates. If you want to be a good boy, then you have to be nice to your classmates, whether you're with your lab partner or talking to some kids on the bus to school. Treating other people with kindness and respect is one major way to be a good boy. Don't put down students who don't do as well in school as you or make fun of people for their clothes or their general appearance. Work to truly treat others as you'd like to be treated and you'll be on your way to being a good boy. 10. You may think that putting down other people will make you look better, but really, the best thing you can do is be friendly to everybody and most especially those who are being bullied by other students. In addition to feeling great about yourself, people like you and feel comfortable around you. If someone in class doesn't know something, don't make fun of that person and help him or her understand the material instead. You can also be friendly and provide a positive voice in non-academic situations, such as when eating lunch in the cafeteria or peeing in the boys' bathroom. 4. 4. Participate in class. Another way to be a good boy is to participate in class. This shows your teachers that you're listening and that you care. When your teacher asks questions, you should make an effort to answer them while giving other people a chance to answer, too. If you're interested in or confused by something, then you should ask your teacher questions when it's appropriate. If you're engaged in class and participate often, then you'll be making learning more fun for yourself while being a good boy in the process. 11. If your teacher asks for a volunteer, help her out by participating in whatever activity she has planned. Make sure to participate in group work, too. You should always be active and engaged with the material. 5. 5. Follow the rules. In order to be a good boy in school, you should avoid having conflicts with your teachers and your administrators. Follow all of the rules at your school, from any dress code rules you have to follow to coming to school on time and acting respectful in the school cafeteria. If you have broken a rule, be honest about it and apologize and show that you won't do it again. If you want to be a good boy, then listening to the rules is important. If you want to be a good student, then it's important to follow the rules in your school. You don't want to develop a bad reputation with your teachers. If you do that, then it'll be hard for them to take you seriously. 6. 6. Don't be arrogant. Good boys don't try to act like the smartest person in the room or question their teacher's authority for the sake of causing problems. Whether you're hanging out with your friends during recess or listening to your teacher talk about George Washington, you should avoid acting like a know-it-all, or you're likely to annoy the people around you. Though it's important to be curious and to question things in order to reach your own conclusions, you shouldn't show off or brag or act like you know more than other people if you want to be a good boy. Trying to outsmart your teachers is one of the worst things you can do if you want them to like you. If you try these antics, they'll be making a fast phone call to your parents. Of course, if you have a legitimate concern, you can still bring it up to your teacher. Just make sure you do so in a respectful manner. Showing off in front of your friends isn't a good idea, either. They'll quickly get tired of your act. 7. Be honest. 12. It's important to be honest if you want to be truly good in school and outside of it. If you're in trouble for breaking the rules, then be honest about what you did instead of lying and trying to cover it up. When it comes to tests, you should avoid cheating or engaging in other dishonest behavior and work on getting good grades honestly, through studying and hard work. If you're dishonest in school, then that will make you dishonest in other parts of your life and will lead you to not be a good boy. Though it's okay to tell an occasional white lie to save a person's feelings, such as telling your friend you like his bad haircut, it's important to have integrity. When it comes to the important stuff, make sure to tell your teachers and parents the truth, or you'll make a lifelong bad habit. It's not always easy to be honest. If you're honest about something that is difficult to share, then you should be proud of yourself for opening up. 8. Be organized. Good boys tend to be organized in school, so that they can focus on their studies without making a mess. Have an organized backpack, school and home desk, notebook, and anything else you use for school. Work on separating your school subjects by folder and always knowing where everything is. If you want to succeed in school and be a good boy, then it's important to be on top of your organizational skills. 13. Being organized goes hand in hand with being. Make sure that your desk at home, your desk at school, and your locker or backpack are neat and organized. Taking just 10 to 15 minutes a day to clean your things can help you stay on top of your studies. It is very helpful to keep a planner with all things you have to do and due dates. Part 3. Being a good boy with others. Download article. 1. Be respectful. If you want to be a good boy, then it's important to treat other people with respect. Whether they are your parents, friends, or your dentist, it's important to be nice and respectful to the people around you and to treat them with basic kindness. Respect their space. Ask them how they're doing, and avoid asking overly personal questions. Being respectful is an important quality of a good boy as well as a good man. 14. Good boys are respectful, especially of their elders. Make sure to treat people who are older than you with the utmost respect, even if you may disagree with them sometimes. When you're in public, make sure you're not too loud and avoid not cleaning up your mess. A restaurant or movie theater isn't your bedroom, and you need to be aware of the people around you. 2. Be nice to your neighbors. Another way to be a good boy is to be nice to your neighbors. Avoid making too much noise, accidentally getting on their property, ignoring them, or generally not treating them kindly. Your parents will want you to be nice to them to help make a good impression for your family, and being nice to them will make your living situation much easier. Even if you feel like you don't have a lot in common with them, it's always important to be nice. 15. Just making polite small talk can make a big difference. When you see your neighbors, just say, "Hi, how are you?" You don't have to get wrapped up in a long conversation with them, but take the time to acknowledge them. 3. Be kind to girls. One of the most important parts of being a good boy is treating girls with the kindness and respect they deserve. Be nice to them, make an effort to get to know them, and only tease them if you're both being playful. Don't ever make demeaning or nasty comments to a girl or make her feel bad about her looks or who she is. Even if the other boys around you aren't mature enough to be nice to girls yet, it's important that you break this mold and make an effort to treat them with care and kindness. When you see a girl, be friendly and ask how she's doing. You can even compliment her new haircut or a piece of jewelry she's wearing. If you're shy about talking to girls, you don't have to force it. The more you talk to girls little by little, the more comfortable you'll feel about opening up to them. 4. Be polite. Being polite is an important part of being a good boy. Being polite means treating others with kindness and respect, avoiding being vulgar, and showing a kind interest in people. It also means avoiding any offensive topics or being rude to the people you don't like. While you don't have to be best friends with everyone, it doesn't take any effort to be polite, and it can help make your social situations easier. 16. Being polite also means having good manners. Avoid burping in public and excuse yourself if you do. Don't chew with your mouth full. Ask people how they're doing when you see them. If you're introduced to a new person, stand up to say hello. Let people pass in front of you instead of butting in front of them. 5. Help out in your community. If you want to be a good boy, then you should work on volunteering in your community to help make the world a better place. You can volunteer with your parents, or jump on your bicycle to go by yourself or with some friends if you're old enough to do that. You can help clean up a local park, help people learn to read at the library, or volunteer in a soup kitchen to help people have access to food. To be a good boy, you have to know that it's about more than just being good at school or at home, but in the world at large. Make an effort to give at least a few hours of your time to others a month. Whether you're volunteering through your school, church, or another community organization. If you help out with your parents, then this will also be a great bonding activity. 6. Spread your positive energy. To be a good boy out in the world, it's important to spread your positive energy and to make the people around you feel happier and better about the world. You should avoid complaining or being overly negative and should work on talking about all of the good things in your life, smiling and complimenting people instead of being negative or only focusing on the bad things in life. If you want to be a good boy, then you want to work on spreading good in the world. 17. Work on complimenting people instead of criticizing them. It's a better people to make people feel good about themselves than to put them down. 18. Work on smiling more often too. It'll make you and the people around you feel happier. Expert Q&A. Ask a question. Submit tips. Go above and beyond by sticking up for people when you see they're in need and trying to resolve bad situations when they arise. Tips from our readers. Do things without being asked to show that you're putting in effort and care about your family and loved ones. For example, if you're home alone, tidy up a common area in the house. Take care of your own belongings, as well, to show that you respect the things around you and are responsible. Submit a tip. All tip submissions are carefully reviewed before being published. Submit warnings. Truth will win all the time. Never tell lies. Do not resort to physical violence against a bully except when it is the only thing you can do to stop him from physically hurting you or someone else. Avoid taking this further than necessary. If you are caught in a lie, the consequences will be worse than if you had told the truth. How to run away from an abusive home. Download article. Parts. 1. How to reach out to others for help. 2. How to create an escape plan. 3. How to understand your options as a runaway. Other sections. Tips and warnings. Related articles. References. Article summary. Co-authored by Sabrina Grover, LMSW. Last updated, the 20th of May, 2024. Approved. You deserve to feel safe. If you feel trapped by an abusive spouse, parent, or family member, running away and finding a safe space may be the only option. If all other attempts to resolve the situation calmly and peacefully have failed, you can carefully plan your escape and find a safe place to stay. Take action and protect yourself. If you're in immediate danger, or suspect your internet usage may be monitored, call the National Domestic Violence Hotline immediately by dialing 1-800-799-7233. Part 1. How to reach out to others for help. Download article. 1. Ask yourself a few questions before you take action. Though you may feel like running away is the only answer, take time to think before you make the drastic decision to leave home. This step is useful for teenagers who are upset or angry at their parents but are not sure if their parents' actions justify leaving home. Consider the following questions. Am I in danger if I stay at home? This question is important, as it will help you determine if you need to take action to get out of the home. If you feel the abuse at home is out of control and dangerous to your safety, there may not be anything you can do to change the environment and it may be time to get out. How will I survive? This question is useful especially for teens who are not sure where they will live or how they will survive once they run away from home. Creating an escape plan and taking steps to adjust once you leave the home will help you answer this question. Your escape plan should specify a safe place you can go to and numbers for runaway helplines where you can speak to professionals who can help you survive and thrive outside of the abusive home. Who can I count on to help me? This question can help you to identify any support lines you may have around you, from a trusted friend to a professional support person. 1. You should also have at least one emergency contact that you can rely on in the event you end up in trouble while on your own. 2. 2. Talk to a trusted friend or family member about your decision. If you are a teen who is trying to escape an abusive environment, you may want to reach out to an elder that you trust and can confide in. Share your fears and your decision to leave the home. They may be able to support you in your decision and help you get out of the home. They can also help you put your fears into perspective and give you an outside view of the situation. This step can also be useful for adults who are trying to get out an abusive home environment, as confiding in a trusted friend or family member can help you to create an escape plan and feel confident enough to put it in motion. 3. 3. Speak to a professional counselor or support person for help. Search online for the youth hotline in your state or area and get in touch with them. Explain your situation and get advice on how to effectively escape from the home. Speaking to a professional can also help you prepare for your escape and ensure that you have a network of professional support for when you do decide to leave the home. There are usually professional counselors that answer the phones on these helplines. They may ask you to provide your name or they may allow you to stay anonymous. Their job is to listen to your issues at home and make suggestions on safe places to go or actions you can take to get out of a dangerous situation. You can also contact the National Runaway Safe Line, 1-800-RUNAWAY, or the National Runaway Switchboard, 800-621-4000, a 24 hotline that can connect you to professional services for runaways in your area. Part 2. How to create an escape plan. Download article. 1. 1. Arrange a safe place to go to. One of the key details of your escape plan is having a safe place to go to once you leave the abusive home. 2. This could be a trusted relative's home, a close family member's home, or a runaway shelter. You can also stay at a hotel for a night or two if you are of age. You should arrange your stay with a relative or family member beforehand. You can also stay with a close friend. It is not against the law for someone to take you in if they believe you are in danger. But if the adults in the safe place do anything illegal or lie to the authorities about your whereabouts, they can be charged with contributing to the delinquency of a minor. Call the shelter near you and let them know when you plan to leave so they are aware of when you are going to be there. 2. 2. Avoid sleeping on the streets. Though it may be challenging to find a safe place to go, leaving without a safe place can lead to a night or several nights spent sleeping on the streets. Often, the streets can be very dangerous and risky, especially if you are a teenager. Avoid this option by arranging for a safe place before you leave the abusive home. 3. 3. Save as much money as you can. You are going to need cash on hand to pay for your stay at a hotel and other basic amenities you may need as you transition out of the abusive home. 3. Try to save as much cash as you can and store it in a safe place where it cannot be found. If you are a teenager who is planning to run away from home, you can likely find a runaway shelter where you can stay there for free for a few nights. You may also be able to stay with a friend or a relative for free until you figure out where you are going to live permanently. If you are an adult trying to get out of an abusive home, you may have a joint bank account with your abusive spouse. Apply for a new bank account at a bank that is close to the safe place you will be heading to when you leave the home. You may need a new permanent address, such as the safe place address, to apply for a new bank account. Doing this will cut you off from your abusive spouse and make it harder for them to find you. 4. Pack the basic necessities. Bring a few changes of clothing, toiletries, identification documents, and any small sentimental items. Try to fit these items in a small bag so you can carry it easily with you when you leave. Make sure you also bring cash with you as you will need this to pay for items. Once you leave, avoid using credit cards as these can be used to locate you. 5. Remove any traces of your escape plans from your computer or phone. Once you have an escape plan in place, it's important that you get rid of any traces of your escape plan that may be on your computer or your phone. This will prevent the abuser in your home from finding out about your plans and ensure your escape plan will be successful. 6. Go to the safe place and do not tell your abusers where you are. Per your escape plan, take your packed bag and go to your agreed upon safe place. Time this for when the abuser is out of the house or when you are alone in the house. Avoid giving your abuser any indication of where you have gone, as this could place you in danger. You may use public transportation, such as a bus or a train, to get out of the abusive home and go to the safe place. Or, you may be able to arrange a pickup a few blocks away from the abusive home through the person who lives in the safe place, if they have a car. If you believe you are in danger and cannot get out of the home, despite your escape plan, call 911 or a domestic abuse helpline. Part 3. How to understand your options as a runaway. Download article. 1. Be aware of your rights as a runaway. If you are a minor, under 18 years of age, and you decide to run away from an abusive home, you should be aware of your legal status as a runaway. Though state laws can vary, in general, your parents have a legal right to call the police and report you missing. The police may then try to locate you and bring you home. If you are older than 18 years of age and are running away from an abusive spouse, the police do not have the jurisdiction to return you to the home. As a minor, you can prevent the police from taking you back to the abusive home. If you explain your situation, describe in detail the abuse you have suffered and let the police know that you are afraid to return to the home. The police will then take you to Child Protective Services. The CPS worker will then listen to the details of your situation and determine if your parents are providing a safe and stable environment for you as a minor. If they determine this is not the case, they can authorize your removal from the abusive home. 2. Go to a runaway shelter or stay with a relative. If the CPS worker determines that it is not safe for you to return to the abusive home, they will suggest that you stay with a relative or with someone you feel safe being around. If you do not have a safe place to stay, they will refer you to a runaway shelter. A professional counselor will talk to you at the runaway shelter and allow you to stay there if you are at least 12 years of age, you are mature enough to stay in the shelter, and it is clear you are in danger if you return home. Though the shelter staff may tell your parents where you are, your parents cannot simply take you from the shelter. Some shelters require parental permission to house runaways and some do not. talk to the shelter about their rules. You can find out more information on runaway shelters through the National Runaway Safe Line, 1-800-RUNAWAY. The safe line is open 24 hours a day and can refer you to professional support people in your area. 4. 3. 3. Adjust your personal documentation so you cannot be found. Once you are in a safe place, it is important that you take steps to remain hidden from your abuser. This is especially applicable if you are running away from an abusive spouse. Change your address and get a new bank account. You can also change your social security number so your abuser cannot use it to try to locate you. Call the social security office near you and explain you are a victim of domestic abuse. They will often let you change your social security number due to abuse circumstances. You may also want to consider hiring a lawyer, especially if you are going to have to fight for custody of your children or your assets. Expert Q&A. Ask a question. Submit tips. If you're in immediate danger, call the National Domestic Violence Hotline right away at 1-800-799-7233. Tips from our readers. Try leaving a note to the cops where your parents won't find it, but the cops will. The note should explain your exact situation and reason for leaving, explaining why your parents aren't fit to raise you anymore. An open church is a good place to go, especially if your abuser is a believer, possible, but not likely. Even if you aren't, everyone there is. And church sanctuaries are considered very safe.